Okay, welcome everyone to Walking Together in the WOW here. This is the main channel that other channels branch off from. I have four other sub-channels of this channel. The Dharma King, Ramana Maharshi, Dharma Queen, Sri Sri Anandamayi, Dharma King Jesus, and Dharma King Longchenpa. Four channels that are more specialized, a little bit more specialized, where we have content for Ramana Maharshi, Longchenpa, Jesus, and Sri Sri Anandamayi. For those who might want to specialize a little bit or get the flavor of that, okay, that emphasis. So I'm not lumping them all together on this channel anymore. I'm not lumping them all together. I'm going to put these videos on these other channels. And how to get to these channels is down in the below the video, in the video description. Click on Show More, and I have all the links there. I also have pictures on Google Plus page. You go Google Plus page, and then compilations, or also posts or compilations, and I have pictures and various content on the Google Plus pages. It's working very nicely, actually. It's about, you know, the only use for Google Plus, it's too complicated, people can't figure it out, but it's nice, it works this way. So thank you, Google Plus, and thank you, YouTube, for hosting this, really. I mean, it's useful. I mean, it's redemptive for Google and YouTube and all these folks. It's redemptive. It's a positive thing for them. That something helpful is being made of all of this. And gratitude, you know, is hey, it all helps, doesn't it? So I do have these sub channels set up, and I'm working on them here again. Also, you can get to them up on the banner of this website. Christ Clarity, full stop in the WOW. Full stop in the WOW. Or Walking Together in the WOW. I guess I call it Walking Together in the WOW. The banner on the right lower corner, you see these little YouTube icons and arrow with arrow, and there's four of those. And then there's a website also, which I still have to work more on that. I'm not really got that up to speed at all yet. So don't worry about the website. And then click on one of these four icons. It will take you to one of these four sub-channels of this channel. A lot of interesting content will come with it. This helps you abide in the court of the Dharma King. We'll call it abidance in the court of the Dharma King is a way we just use speak of this general. Dharma means spiritual protection. So I'm working on this. And you can subscribe to those other channels, absolutely. I don't have comments on them. I may not even have likes on it. It doesn't matter, because you're coming there from here, so to speak. These are like sister channels of this channel. This is the umbrella channel here of these other channels where I talk and I explain the overall gist of everything that's going on here. And it's getting very intense now. I had another dream last night of waves, surfers out in waves, and the waves got bigger and bigger, and they started getting wiped out. And I said, uh-oh, it's coming. The wipeout is coming. I said, oh my gosh, it's getting too big to handle. It's getting too intense to handle in the world. So it is coming, and coming fast. Those who I've talked with, intuitive, say that they think that in May is going to be quite troublesome. We're going to start wiping out, and then what I say, ultimately by July 24th, it's kind of like we're going to tip into very overly intense situation, to say the least. So we want to take refuge. So I'm preparing these, I call them Terma videos. You might see, say, Dharma King Jesus Christ TV1 Terma video. I'm using a term from our beloved Dharma friends from Tibetan Buddhism, from Dharma King Longchenpa. It was Terma treasures is like these spiritual treasures that were like buried or hidden to be revealed later on, because people weren't quite ready for them yet. So this is very, very central to Tibetan Buddhism, is some of these Terma kings, they would bury various teachings, or mind terma, it was be on a subtle mental level. Sometimes there was actual, you know, physical books that were buried. They'd seal them up in the walls of monasteries, a lot of teachings, and then hundreds of years later, they would activate the knowledge that these books were there, and then they'd tear apart the walls of the monastery, and there were all these books that were written by these Dharma kings with very, very advanced, so-called advanced or specialized teachings or something. So I call these terma videos, and then I'm making these videos now, putting these here now to be discovered later. People will start discovering these, and they'll say, hey, this is very helpful. This is very helpful. I didn't even know this was there. Okay, so that's what the TV stands for. It's also funny, it could be on television, you're watching something, like a TV. You can make a TV channel with all these terma videos. So a TV really means terma video. Terma treasures. These are terma treasures. You come across them and say, oh my God, this is wonderful. Thank you so much. This really helps, you know, clue me into of abidance in the core of the Dharma King. So again, have four sister channels to this one. And the links, again, are below every video I do now on this channel. In the video description, below watching the video, below the video, right below, it's a video description, I think it's something like that. And it gives a little, starts out in a few lines, and then show more. Click on show more, drops down many, many links there. I may add some more later on, but that's where you get access to it, okay? Or the banner at the top of this channel. And the blog, my blog will have include these links. I'll try to include these links in every blog post I do also. And the Google Plus pages, I don't know how I can include links from the Google Plus pages, link to other Google Plus pages, but I might be able to. But anyway, you discover, it's a discovery. You keep involving yourself in the court of the Dharma King. Keep involving yourself. That's how you abide. Okay, keep involving yourself in this, and ultimately keep practicing. You have to practice full stop in the wow, because this is the practice of managing your success. This is the key practice. This is the umbrella practice. No matter how you get a glimpse of reality, of truth, of eternal life, no matter how you get a glimpse of this, you have to manage your success of seeing that. So, as you know, we practice full stop in the wow, which is part tortoise, part hare. Part hare, part tortoise. You accelerate. We accelerate, until we're going towards eternal life. Wow! And then we see, oh my gosh, I'm almost there. Oh, then you get jittery. And then what do? You coast. You back off the accelerator and you coast. That's the tortoise. The acceleration is the hare. Backing off is the tortoise. Instead of doing a U-turn and going the opposite direction, which is makes your path incredibly ragged and horrible and conflicted and confusing and chaotic, you don't go make a U-turn and go another direction and put yourself in the jaws of the yoga girls in the sacrificial belief system. You just keep going towards eternal life, but you just coast a little while and let the jitters calm down. You must have faith your jitters will calm down just by this patience, and it does. I'm the Dharma Prince Clarity Ross. I call myself this. This was suggested to me by the Holy Spirit and by Dharma King Longchenpa is because I've been 38 years practicing full stop on the wow and taking the path of repentance intensely for 38 years. So I'm aware of what the troubles are. Okay, so I know that this practice works. I know it's safe. I know it's fast. It's the ultimate practice, really. We have to manage our success on the path, right? And we have to be very skillful at it. And we have to smooth out our path. The problem that we all have is the path is so ragged, isn't it? This is the trouble. And we try to be the hare, you know, and like blast through, you know, treacho, cut through, you know, aggressively, all the absurdity. This is very dangerous to push too hard, especially by using stimulants, sex, drugs, rock and roll, whatever, to try to push us, the backlash comes. The jitters turn into paranoia. So we must co-opt the paranoia. We must cut it short and let it just remain jitters and be very intensely focused on just, I just had the jitters. I'm not going to allow it to turn into paranoia. I'm not going to make a U-turn. If you push the acceleration too fast for too long and don't manage the jitters properly, it will turn into paranoia, and paranoia compounds itself, and then you'll jump back into absurdity, into the jaws of sacrificial death belief system, and you'll be going in the opposite direction as fast as possible, and then your path becomes a freak out, doesn't it? Now, we've all been through this. Maybe you're going through this. I certainly went through that for a long time, and your path is just like crazy. It's too intense. It's too ragged. It's too much suffering, isn't it? It's horrible. And you just say, like, I can't take this. It's just, what do I do? It's off. So, full stop in the wow. Smooths it out. It smooths your path out. You don't get into paranoia. You don't. And so your path, the momentum, it keeps going fast, 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 fast. I mean, this morning I basically started three new religions. That's how fast the momentum is. I say started, but let me say this. Dharma King Christianity, Dharma King Hinduism, and Dharma King Buddhism, which is a purifying of three religions, a simplification of, we can look at, in my channel I call it Dharma King Christianity. I might even change the titles of the websites, like Dharma King Christianity. That's very possible. Dharma King Buddhism, Dharma King Hinduism, and Dharma King Non-Dualism. Four different channels. Dharma King Christianity, represented by the great Dharma King Jesus Christ. I don't need to say great, that's redundant. Dharma King is someone who's completely free of both personal continuity fear and collective continuity fear. Totally beyond it all. Okay. Beyond the beyond. Dharma King Hinduism, represented by Sri Sri Anandamayi. Dharma King Buddhism, represented by Longchenpa. Dharma King Non-Dualism, represented by Ramana Maharshi. Now, Ramana, you could say Hinduism too, but he was sort of beyond Hinduism, wasn't he? He was so profound that he's sort of given rise to this non-dualism, right, in the world, through Punjaji and various, you know, he's like the father of this non-dualist, modern non-dualism, isn't he? He is. Dharma King Ramana Maharshi. Dharma King non-dualism. Dharma King non-dualism. I like the ring of Dharma King Christianity. It's like, wow. Yeah, what a great way to look at this. You can say, I'm a Dharma King Christian. What kind of Christian are you? You're a Christian? Yeah, I'm a Dharma King Christian. I'm a Dharma King Christian. Very alliterative, actually. Dharma King Christian. What's that? Well, I take refuge in the court of the Dharma King Jesus Christ. Dharma King Jesus Christ. I abide in the court of the Dharma King Jesus Christ. What is Dharma King? It's Dharma is spiritual protection. The king is all-powerful, all-authoritative, all-powerful, all-authoritative spiritual protection. And we label that, based on tradition, we can label that Jesus Christ has a certain style. Jesus has a certain style. Okay. Now, these Dharma kings and queens have their own style. In reality, we're all one, and yet we also have a certain uniqueness, Jesus tells us, actually. He says, I can't really explain this. Just have faith that this is so. And so I just take it on faith. This is so. And it plays out that way. I mean, Ramana Maharshi, Dharma King Ramana Maharshi has his style, right? They have their own style. They have their certain emphasis, right? So there's these emphases and styles. But what they're pointing to is exactly the same. pure freedom, or pure freedom. All is God, all is pure causation. Nothing's ever happened, actually, to reality. Nothing's ever happened. They're all pointing to exactly the same freedom. Okay? So I've worked in all four of these Dharma King and Queen's courts. Comfortable in all four courts. And I know they're all pointing to exactly the same freedom, exactly the same realization. It's just slightly differing styles. So I go from one court to the other, that is true. Pragmatically, at some point, maybe I'll be affiliated with one on the pragmatic level. But that doesn't mean that I'm not affiliated with the others. It just sometimes you might work with one Dharma King, you know, more directly or something to help certain others. If that's more effective, that's fine. Maybe I'll work with Longchenpa. That's quite possible. Quite possible. I tend to like his emphasis, the way he emphasizes. I tend to feel that's particularly effective right now for certain types. I've had a lot of trouble trying to help those with Jesus Christ because the immaturity of Christians right now is quite strong. It's quite strong. They're very juvenile. They've gotten really, and I explained this on the channel. You know, I explained to Dharma King Christians, you know, what their trouble is. I explained it very clearly. Whereas there's less baggage with Longchenpa. There's a lot less baggage. People just come kind of with a blank slate, like, oh, okay, I don't, you know, don't have any opinion one way or the other. So they're open-minded, flexible, and okay, what is just there? Let me just see what's there. And then, ah, oh, you see what's there, and you say, oh, wow. Yeah, you look into the mind of the Dharma King or Queen, and it's just, wow, it's ineffable. Jesus says, start with words, and then you know, use those words gently, and then gently go beyond the words to the beingness, to the ineffable beingness. And as of course, as you do this and you succeed at this, there's the backlash will come, and so coast in the wow, full stop in the wow. You're not hitting the brake and you're not hitting the accelerator. You're coasting. This is a good way of looking at it. And so I do shop talk, you know, I'm aware of this dynamic, so I accelerate and then I back off, accelerate, back off here in what I explain and what I'm talking here. Sometimes we even talk about the weather or whatever, right? The weather's always there. It's foggy this morning in California, but it will burn off. We're going towards a heat wave, actually, this week, mini heat wave. But it's not burning off yet. This is lingering a lot longer today, that is for sure. I was smart enough to wear another warm layer, otherwise I'd be freezing out here. I guess it's a little chilly, because the fog, the marine layer is here. So we have chit-chat. We go into chit-chat, you know, occasionally, but we're coasting. We're not making a U-turn and deciding to align ourselves with the Vestal Virgins and the Yoga Girl operatives that work for them, which is the cult of sacrifice. It's the cult of sacrifice. Cult of death is what it is. We're not reversing our direction. No, we're not at all. Not at all. But we coast a little bit. Coast a little bit. I used to talk about sports a little. Well, not much. Because I'm stopped sports. I'm boycotting sports in terms of following sports. Holy Spirit told me it's time to boycott storylines. You can't get hooked in any storyline right now. The trouble is too intense that's coming. I still play a little, try to play golf or practice golf or just fool around with golf swing. I use that as an analogy sometimes. I have a good golf swing going right now. I think, I hope, I expect. You know, we'll see, but it keeps getting better. I found a way to to make it more repetitive, to smooth it out. And there's a couple of keys that I use. A couple of keys. Very interesting keys. If you're a golfer, you'd be interested in this. Instead of aligning like my nose or face or eye with the ball or my head, I act like I'm trying to put the ball in my ear, like my left ear is lined right over the ball. And I try to keep my left ear aligned right over the ball, as if the ball is like trying to stick the ball in my ear, so to speak. And this has worked fabulously well. It's a whole different key. Instead of my chin, my face, my head, my house burns my head. No, it's just I have my left ear, I tilt it so it's aligned right over that ball, and as if the ball is almost ready to stick it in my ear. So keep this idea of I'm going to stick the ball in my ear. And I don't go off of that until I've already hit the ball. I try to keep it there. And wow, did that smooth out the swing. And the other one is to keep my left arm actually tight, right at the shoulder, tight to my body, and don't try to separate it. So this gives me an accurate distance to actually how my swing's actually going to hit the ball. Otherwise, if I extend my arms out too far, and when I actually swing, it pulls it in closer to my body, and I end up hitting the ball on the toe of the club. This is a big problem people have. They miss the sweet spot. So the idea is don't open the club face, and make sure you hit the sweet spot. Those are the two keys to hitting it well. You got to hit the sweet spot, and you can't open the club up. And so by keeping my ear there, I prevent my body from opening up. And by keeping my arm not too far extended and being able to gauge it just accurately every time, that enables me to hit the sweet spot properly. So those are the two keys, and I've got a couple of ways to key in on that. So it's just a little chit-chat, but it relates back to our spiritual path and full stop on the wow, is we have these keys that helps us full stop in the wow. We do some assertions, and we do flipping the script, and this brings the wow, and then we full stop in the wow. So we need, the full stop in the wow might be like a golf swing. How do we smooth it out? How do we make it repetitive? How do we do it, you know, well every time? And this is what I'm helping with. I'm here to help with this practice, encourage you to do this practice, because this is the essential practice to abide in the court of the Dharma King. The essential practice. You have to manage your success. You cannot be reversing field and jumping into the jaws of sacrifice and say, well, yeah, you know, bring your yoga girl or yoga guy along with you and say, yeah, well, they help me because as I get too close to eternal life, then I go there, they help me go in the opposite direction. This causes your path to be a nightmare. And of course, most people say, well, the path is so difficult. That's because we're not doing it right. We're not doing it right when we keep reversing, going in the opposite direction. And then we try to find middle ground between two opposite directions, and this results in mental chaos, which is just really super fast oscillation. There can't be actually a middle ground between two opposite directions. There can only be oscillation. And so what we do then is we try to oscillate so fast, it feels like super chaotic, mental chaos. So the answer is just go in one direction. It's the only answer there is. So in order to do that, you have to practice full stop in the wow. You have to practice that to keep going in just one direction. And we keep it simple here, because it's simple is better. Simple is better. We can just say, don't fixate on no fixation. It is a key. It's a very nice key, isn't it? Don't fixate on no fixation. And another key is, I can, I will, I've already done it. These are two keys to smooth out your practice. So you might have a couple of keys that smooth out the practice. I can, I will, I've already done it. I can, I will, I am. I already am. I can, I will, I already am. I can succeed, I will succeed. I've already succeeded. I can be a success, I will be a success. I already am a success. Very helpful to calm down and smooth things out. And then That's so helpful. I'm smoothed out. Like, wow, it's so helpful. This is like my image, just wow. Wonderful. So this is an example of when you blank out, that means you're in the wow mode. Okay. So I can abide in the court of the Dharma King. I will abide in the court of the Dharma King. I'm already abiding in the court of the Dharma King. I'm already abiding in the court of the Dharma King. So at any point you suddenly feel this wow, you just go right into the practice. By whatever technique you use, just full stop in the wow. No fixation on no fixation is the other key. Is okay. What am I doing? Well, I'm not fixating on anything, and I'm not fixating on no fixation. This really helps. I'm not fixating on no fixation. Very helpful. No fixation on no fixation. No fixation on no fixation. No fixation on no fixation. And I can, I will, I already have. I've already done it. I can abide in the court of the Dharma King. I will abide in the court of the Dharma King. I'm already abiding in the court of the Dharma King. No fixation on no fixation, full stop in the wow. So those are two keys. Now, like if a golf swing, there are other things, but I'm not really keying on them so much. I mean, I'm used to that, and it, you know, weight forward on the balls of your feet. Don't go back on your heels. Arch the back. But all that stuff is pretty much, you know, where the alignment, how to align, and where the ball is, that's pretty basic. You do that. It gets pretty automatic. Full stop in the wild gets pretty automatic. You don't advance, you don't retreat, you don't wander off on a side trip. You're not planning. You're not figuring out, how did I get here? Where am I going? You're not projecting in the future. How did I get here? Where am I going? What do I do right now? What's my planning? What's my thinking? Do I need to organize? What do I need to decide? Okay, what's my action going to be? None of those. You don't do any of that. You're not taking any action. You're not leading up to any action right now. You're just coasting. And with faith. You're having faith in your momentum. Have faith in your momentum. The work you did, the glimpse, that is powerful. The reverberations are powerful. And just have faith. And this is what I've discovered. You do move fast, fast, fast. You do. Glimpsing truth is very powerful. It's an extreme attraction to you. And this attraction is pulling you. It absolutely is. But we don't fixate on that attraction. We don't fixate on no fixation. We do not. We mind our business. We do our practice. The essential decorum in the court of the Dharma King is practice. That is the essential decorum. And the practice is full stop in the wow. That's common to all. It's common to all. Now, everyone that comes to the court of the Dharma King, each has unique aspects of themselves. And they'll have some uniqueness to the stuff that they've been doing before. But the common camaraderie, common denominator in the court of the Dharma King is this full stop in the wow practice. Everyone practices that, which is really managing our success, accelerating coasting towards the attraction of eternal life, attraction of sanity, really. Really, sanity is very attractive, okay? It's very attractive. And we only personalize sanity at the level of the Dharma King or Dharma Queen. But even then, they help us go beyond any personalization or label of it. Don't personalize it to a Dharma prince or princess. Okay, I won't have any of that. That turns into a personality cult and whatever. That is not allowed. That is not allowed. So if you want to personalize it, it's to a Dharma King or Dharma Queen. Personalize it to Ramana Maharshi, for instance. But even there, the practice is more important than the personalization of it. Okay, we're not into guru worship here. Okay, we are not. We don't do that, really. We don't do that. We can homage, we can do homage and thanks and all gratitude to the great Dharma King Jesus Christ, and our, you know, all praise to the great Dharma King Longchenpa. Thank you so much for the help that we are receiving in your presence. But it's not guru worship. We don't do that. We focus on full stop in the wow practice, because this is what gets us there. Because this is managing our success. Become better and better managers of our success. And this enables us to go faster and faster and faster, because we're confident. We say, oh, if I get the jitters, I know what to do. No problem. I'll coast for a little while. So then you go faster and faster and faster, because you know you've got a safety net. It's like being a tightrope walker with a safety net, and you can practice better and better and better. Because, you know, if you fall, you got a safety net, right? Whereas if there's no safety net, how can you practice well? You'll be freaked out. It's too scary, isn't it? So we have this wonderful safety net. So we get better and better and better going, accepting the attraction of truth, the great attraction of truth. It's a wonderful attraction. Supremely attractive. There's no way around it. There's no way around it. That attraction is within all of us. And we can never be free of it. We have to submit to it, to surrender to it, succumb to it, surrender to it, the attraction, but bit by bit by bit, because we get these jitters. And all these arguments between sudden and gradual enlightenment, it's six of one, half a dozen of the other. I mean, in some, like for instance, Zen school or something, they'll push the Treksho thing, they'll push sudden enlightenment, bam, and you'll have a breakthrough. And then you spend like 30 years integrating it into your life, or the rest of your 40 years, 50 years, whatever, right? But they call it sudden enlightenment. Another way, we'll go, you get gradual glimpse, gradual glimpse, gradual glimpse, and you're integrating it all along, and then you reach a point where it's just all integrated, and you're abiding, okay, in the now. And they call that, well, that's gradualist. Well, it's the same thing. It's really the same. It's six of one, half a dozen of the other, actually. I mean, I could say I woke up in 1978. I did. I was enlightened. I woke up, and I saw the folly of this duality and this, and what, how we're stuck. I mean, I was awakened, but then I realized that I'm going to sink back into, because a collective continuity fear of the world and my continuity fear. So I've spent the next 38 years evaporating the continuity fear. Well, is that sudden enlightenment and then managing it, or is that gradualism? It's both and neither. It's six of one, half a dozen others. You can say it's both and neither is how we look at it. So a lot of these dilemmas that people bring with them, we just say it's both and neither. And let it go with that. Wow. This is a part of our discipline. We don't struggle with it. We don't struggle with both and neither as a path. We can use that as a technique occasionally as possible, right? But it's more of just like, you know, we're saying, hey, let's not get sidetracked by these side, that's a side trip. So it's both and neither. Six of one, half a dozen of the other. Because we have been sidetracked for millennia by these ridiculous squabbles, really. And we're here to transcend all that nonsense, because we have a practice that works and puts fake life and fake death to rest for once and for all. Which is, the real problem is continuity fear. Even if we get some answer to, is it gradual, is it this, we still have to manage our success. We still have the continuity fear. And this practice is still full stop in the wow. However you want to define it, these are all, you know, these are ridiculous quibbles that have caused so much delay in history. So much delay. And so it's both and neither. It gets us off of that. That's just our answer. It's both and neither. Is that an answer, or is it just saying, don't worry about it, it's not important? There's no ultimate answer to it, really. You know, the answer is full stop in the wow practice, really. The answer is to manage your successes, manage your jitters. That's the real answer. Whether you get a blast of jitters to start with, and then you spend 40 years gradually overcoming the continuity fear to the reverberations of this blast, or do you take little doses of it and dissipate? There's two. You can dissipate it, but you know it's just your own style, really. It both ends up the same. If there's two paths up the mountaintop, they both end up the same. So what are we talking about? It's a waste of time. However you're doing, you're still managing your success. One is managing their gradual success. One is managing coming to grips with their all-at-once success. That may take them 40 years to come to grips with that. And the gradual one may take them 40 years to come to grips with that there's only success. Yeah, I'm totally successful. They eventually accept, okay, I'm totally successful. And they've come to grips with that. The other will have this say, I'm totally successful, and then take 40 years to come to grips with that. You know, they have it up front. It's front loaded. The other's back loaded. One runs up the mountain really fast, but then towards the top, they're like, oh, I'm real tired. And they drag themselves up. It's like real slow. Others start out slow, stay slow, and keep going kind of slow. But towards the top, they still feel kind of good and fresh, and they can finish to the top. So they both get there at the same time. Yeah, it's different styles, right? Different styles is all we're talking about, really. But boy, how absurdity has played with this and spun us off into side trips throughout history and we're just putting all that behind us here. Absolutely. There's no place for any of that kind of stuff here. As a Dharma prince, I have to squelch that, you know. I have to squelch it. I know the decorum in the court. I mean, the all-at-once ones, a lot of them, they don't manage it properly. They sink back down into delusion again. Absolutely. So it may seem, I mean, I'd say that all-at-once is more egotistical if you look at it in a certain way. It's like, look what I can do. You know, look how awesome I can, you know, I'm so great. It is somewhat arrogant. It's not really accounting for the continuity theory. It's kind of it's a daring, adventurous way of doing it, which is fine, actually. But it's not necessarily the wisest way. Six of one, half a dozen of another. You could say it's expressing our beingness clearly by being so adventurous and daring, yes. But you could say it's the heart way of like, I'm all heart, I can do it. It's the leaping way. But oftentimes, then you end up with the danger of setting yourself up as a teacher or something, as a Dharma king, when you haven't really integrated, haven't dissipated all the continuity fear, and you can then easily get pulled back down. So I would say it's a daring way, but it's a more dangerous way. It's a more dangerous way too. It's both daring and dangerous, whereas the gradual way is a safer way. It's a more humble way. It's a safer way. It's not full of the it avoids the drama of the all at once and the possibility of thinking that, hey, I'm enlightened, I've got it, and I'm teaching others, and this is, you know, and then the troubles come in, and the yoga girls get a hold of you, and it's trouble, and the trouble gets worse, and you keep fighting against it. There's examples of this. There are teachers, you know, like a teacher goes to Punjaji or something, and the Punjaji says, you're enlightened, and they get it. There's this huge all at once breakthrough, and they think, I'm a guru, now I'm a teacher, and then they set up shop, and big people come to them, and they're this, you know, and then the wheels start coming off, and the yoga girls start getting their, you know, start seducing them and going the other direction, saying, oh, this is, you need to balance out, you need to balance, we have a balance here and of direction. You go this direction, then go back this direction. And then it turns into a nightmare. It turns into a nightmare. It turns into a nightmare. So this, a lot of the teachers in the world are these all at once, sudden enlightenment school teachers. And the reason why they have problems is a lot of these teachers have turned out, have severe problems. Severe problems. Because a lot of them use sex, drugs, and rock and roll to make the breakthrough. You know, it wasn't properly grounded, or they wanted, you know, their show-offs, or they wanted to be daring or adventurous. You know, a lot of different, you know, all part of the thing of, you know, that. And then they didn't have the discipline. They said, no, I got to get into this right now. You know, I feel like I'm just, you know, awesome, and I can bring everybody else into that awesomeness suddenly too. And it's a disaster. So the gradualists are not so dramatic and, you know, flamboyant that way, because I just been working like, you know, slaving away as a peon, as a peasant for 38 years, intensely. I'm not a teacher. You know, at this point, you can say I'm a Dharma prince, but a Dharma prince is just a Dharma prince. I'm not a Dharma king or Bodhisattva. No, not at all. I still have the problem of collective continuity fear. Still very vulnerable to the Vestal Virgins of death and sacrifice, the sacrificial Vestal Virgins and all their influence, which is way, way too intense right now in this world. I can't stand up to it. Who can? Except the only ones that can stand up to a Dharma king, Dharma queen. That's it. Only they can truly stand up to it, because they have no continuity fear, no collective continuity fear, no personal fear, none. But other than that, I don't think anyone can stand up to it. Jesus told us that in the end times, it'll be so intense, the horrors of Babylon will be so vicious, that even the saints can't stand up to it. And saints, apostles, those are Dharma princes and princesses. And I see this. I can't stand up to it. I'm not telling you here that I can stand up to the Vestal Virgins and their sacrificial mother goddess cult. No, because the collective continuity fear that they know how to leverage is so terrible that I probably would succumb to like anyone else. So I'm interested in distancing myself from that as much as possible. You know, I get my tongue gets tied. You know, I'm in those situations. Like, I say, what's the matter? How come I cannot be this very poised Dharma prince? Because what they're doing is they're leveraging collective continuity fear to try and intimidate me into taking the sacrificial path, which they feel is the only path there is to salvation, is to kill God. And I say, well, God can't be killed. But I know that, but at the same time, the intimidation, the pressure they use is so severe that I think, like, I don't know what to say. I just feel like, you know, really panicky. You get panicky. So, yeah, Jesus was absolutely right. He said the pressure will be so severe that even the saints will succumb or be in danger of succumbing if we weren't helped out, right? If we don't distance ourselves from this. And I'm a believer that distancing is possible. I don't know exactly how it will take place, but I certainly want it to take place. I certainly want it to take place. I don't want to remain in the jaws of this sacrificial belief system intensity right now. The Vestal Virgins are busting out the hammers. You know, they're saying, we got to keep this sacrificial fire burning and make it burn brighter. And we can't have any wind at all. And the wind of truth must not blow in this world, is their perspective. And they're very seductive, very intimidating, very extremely paranoid. And they have very severe wiles and pressure. And they're very skilled at what they do. They know their business very, very well, how to keep the sacrificial fires burning, how to put out all breezes. And they're going to try to put out all breezes of truth in this world. So I might say, well, I could stand up to you maybe later, not right now, but maybe later I'll stand up to you. Sure, that's fine. I'm fine with that. Because you stand up to one of them, you have to stand up to all of them. All of it. You see, they're working in concert. It's all organized. It's at a deep level. It's all vibrating. It's all got the same purpose, right? It's all pulling in the same direction, actually, you might say. It's all pulling in the same direction. So you're pulling in the other direction. They can say, hey, I'm going to get them to pull, them to pull, them, and them, then all this, and hey. And you find out they're all pulling in the same direction. You thought you had allies and help. And then, wow, it's not that way. Scary. It is scary. It's scary times. There's no question about it. Don't go into denial about it. It's like if you put headphones on, you don't hear yourself scream. Does that mean you're not scared? Of course, it doesn't mean that. Of course, you're scared. So you'd be aware. And the waves of intensity I'm seeing, they're starting to get too heavy, and people are wiping out. They're getting crushed. I saw them paddling out, and I said, uh-oh, doesn't look like they're going to make it. And boom, the wave broke and hammered them. I said, uh-oh, they're starting to get hammered here. No doubt about it. And this has been going on for quite some time. Those are sensitive to it. They've been getting hammered, and they would say, wow, what's happening? Well, what's happening is there's an attempt to make this world a haven for sacrificial religion, belief system, and to completely purify the world, so to speak, of any breezes of truth, true teaching at all, get rid of it, and set up this machinery, a sacrificial machinery, and so more bodies can be sacrificed, and we project our fear of God onto bodies. We made bodies as sacrificial victims. We made nature, all these forms, as sacrificial victims. So we think and their death is in part the death of God. We think we can kill God gradually, bit by bit by bit. One thing I found out, that those who like to argue and pick quibbles about various things, is they're not practicing full stop in the wow. They're not. Because if they were, they'd just say this, I'm full stop in the wow, I'm not thinking anything. I'm not taking any position whatsoever. That's the real practice, no position whatsoever. And they don't get pulled into that. They're quiet. And I invariably find out that they're in bed with yoga girls or yoga guys. They're trying to have their cake and eat it too. They're trying to get the thrills and get the good life, and at the same time, try to get the benefits from the spiritual path. They're trying to get benefits from both paths. This ends up a mess. This is what happens to some of these sudden enlightenment teachers. Is they fall into both pathness, and then they claim crazy wisdom. You know, hey, you know, I'm just wacky. Yeah, well, no, you're conflicted. You're fallen. You're a fallen teacher. You've fallen into the trap that you need, that sudden enlightenment has to be very careful of. You have to be under a teacher. I mean, these sudden enlightenment students, they stay with teachers for a long time, helping them integrate their enlightenment into their everyday life. It's very difficult. But they start teaching. They may say they're a teacher, but they still have teachers that help them out. But like from my standpoint, the Dharma Prince standpoint, I've never been a teacher. My aim was just practice, keep practicing, and find out, get an overview of the whole situation. An overview of the whole situation. So So it's just not just my enlightenment, but the enlightenment of everyone and the difficulties everyone have and how to, you know, smooth out the path, you know, and just a general overview of everything and gradually glimpsing more and more and more and more and more clarity to all this. And a Dharma prince is not claimed to be a teacher, a spiritual teacher, no. I'm just assistant to a Dharma king or a Dharma queen. I'm an assistant to a Dharma king. That's all. I'm just an assistant. That's all. Whatever, however they say, can you help me with this? I say, okay, I can help. I'll help you with this. Can you help me with this way? I can help you with that. Like an assistant. So we have these sudden enlightenment ones who seem very enlightened to start with, right? Nobody tells us that you have to go through this long, long, arduous path of what, quote-unquote, integrating, which really means dealing with collective continuity fear, your own continuity fears, a lot, the backlash and all of that. Nobody tells us this. So we have these gurus that arise, these teachers, and they're enlightened. And they seem very enlightened, and we get pulled in, attracted by this. And then gradually, the wheels start coming off bit by bit by bit. We say, whoa, wait a minute. And then they end up trying to rationalize it. And they all end up trying to rationalize it. And the teacher will say, well, I'm a dangerous individual, you know, but that's part of the practice. And then it gets worse and worse, and they say, well, I'm a crazy person, but that's part of the crazy wisdom thing. And it gets worse and worse and worse, and they end up in a worship cult, you know, I'm greater than God, you need to worship me, you know, it gets worse and worse and worse, trying to rationalize it, so... We try to avoid that here. This hasn't been the path I've been on. I've been on this more bit by bit, glimpse, 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 glimpse. This is the path Jesus advocates, is little glimpse, little glimpse, little glimpse, little glimpse, thousands and thousands of these little glimpses, holy instants, he calls them, where for just an instant you let go of your pretense. You drop the fixation, you might say. He says, stop your thinking or thoughts. But what is thoughts? The thoughts, there's really no such thing. It's just a pretend fixation. Like, oh, I fixated. Or I pretended to fixate. So you kind of ease off this pretending that I can fixate. There's anything to fixate upon, actually. And this gives you a little glimpse. In some way, you get a glimpse of your freedom. And you do. He's accurate. He's so accurate, Jesus. And he says you get more and more familiar with this and more better and better and better and better at it. So you gradually take on more responsibility, like that. But you don't necessarily burst onto the scene like, wow, I had this great, you know, cosmic shower of light and I was the queen of the Dakinis, anointed me as the world master, and I'm lit up, you know, and I'm, you know, and it just, you know, this like sudden, you know, supernova teacher comes on the scene and everybody goes, wow, look at this teacher, I'm writing books, and I'm it, you know, I am it. It hasn't happened that way with me in the slightest bit. It's like, I am not it. The Dharma kings are it. The Dharma kings are it. Jesus is it. You know, I'm a peon compared to Jesus, because he's beyond all collective continuity fear, all cosmic continuity fear. He's beyond all cosmic continuity fear, actually. Now, some of these sudden enlightenment folks are very glib, and they might say this stuff too. Yeah, I'm beyond everything. I just suddenly woke up to my... I realize I'm completely beyond all this. But if they start teaching you guru worship, be careful of that, okay? Really. Just full stop in the wow. Just, and you're in control of your path. You're in control of your path. You're able to monitor your success and your path. And if they don't have any guru that is helping them, if they say, no, I'm so enlightened, I'm above all teachers, I am the master teacher, look out for that. That's trouble. That is trouble. Okay. We here are in the court of the Dharma King and the Dharma Queens, and we've named four of them. Okay. They're in charge, and ultimately the Holy Spirit's in charge of everything. We're not in charge. We're not above them in any way, shape, or form. Now, spiritually, we're equal and one with, because there's just the oneness. But pragmatically, there's a pragmatic fact to all this, so to speak. And pragmatically, we are not their equals. There's a temporarily, we see ourselves in a temporary situation where pragmatically, most certainly, we defer to them. So we're not claiming any exalted status for ourselves here. We're just in the court. Okay, we're in the court. Dharma Prince is a pragmatic term, meaning, you know, steady determination, some usefulness is there. Some usefulness is there. Can be a little more useful, right? So it's an honorific of some sort, but it's not any exalted status. It's not like that. It's a pragmatic status. Where you can help with decorum, you can help point out, this is how we do it, you know, this is how we do it, this is how it's done, this is why it's being done, and, you know, insist on certain parameters and decorum and help with that, yeah. But we are not claiming some ultimate master status, all this kind of nonsense that many have done before who've gotten tricked by a sudden enlightenment sort of situation, and then they couldn't admit the backlash that came. They couldn't admit the egoic backlash that came. And so they just kept doubling down on no, 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 I'm even greater. I'm even more exalted than I said before. I said that I was the greatest, but actually I'm greater. Now I'm greater than the greatest. And then more egoic backlash comes, and they say, oh gosh, what do I do? And they say, well, I'm even greater. And then greater. It's just basically just grrr. You know, they just, how are you? Grrr. The ego backlash, they can't admit to it, you know, because they got too many people thinking they're the ultimate. It's terrible. It's terrible. You don't want that. So just practice full stop on the wow. You have some great breakthrough and you're the one. Okay, great. Full stop on the wow with that. Are you practicing full stop on the wow? Did you realize your eternal life? Okay, wonderful. Are you practicing full stop on the wow? Because for sure, there's going to be backlash. For sure. Did Longchenpa, when he came to me, did he say, hey, I'm the great Dharma King. I'm the greatest Dharma King. I'm the highest of the high. I'm this. No. He just walked casually up to me. I just said, hi. He said, hi. How was the trip here? He said, oh. I said, was it water? How's the ocean? Hot or cold? Warm or cool? It was both. It was both. He didn't say anything really in particular. I guess we chit-chat a little bit. He knows what he is. He knows what his business is. He, you know, so if we have these breakthroughs, realize they're breakthroughs, and there's backlash, and so full stop on the wow. Be humble. Be humble. Remain humble. Listen to Longchenpa's advice, 30 pieces of hard advice or something like that. Wonderful advice. He says, be humble. Be humble. Stay away from troublesome situations. He's aware of all the traps, you know, that we fall into. It's just, don't fall into those traps. There's a trap, the phone, right? Okay, so this is, maybe it's a good time to end here. I've been doing a lot of taping. So we do have these four channels. You can feel free to check them out, sister channels, and we will see how it all unfolds, won't we? But keep your practicing. Take refuge in the court of the Dharma King by practicing full stop in the wow. You'll have your breakthroughs. Coast for a while when you have after breakthrough. Coast. You just coast. Okay? Keep going in the right direction. No U-turns here. No U-turns. Keep going. Keep going in the right direction. And have faith. Have faith. Don't be concerned you have jitters. That jitters happen. Expect them to happen. Be prepared for them to happen. Already be determined that I'm going to handle the jitters by just being calm and humble and patient and full stop in the wow. Remember your keys and don't fixate on no fixation. I can, I will, I'm already there. I can succeed, I will succeed. I have already succeeded. Wow.